I bet you didn't know this trick. If you control click on any function name or variable in VS Code, the editor will take you straight to where that variable or function is declared. For example, when I control clicked on the printf function, VS Code opened the stdio.h header file for me.
That is awesome!
Did you know about this? If not, hit that like button. Speaking of header files, the C language has some great header files for various things. Let's see some header files from the C standard library that can improve your code quality. Starting with time.h header file, which contains various time-related functions. Like this time function gets the current time. This %LD means long decimal. It is used to print a value larger than int. If I run this program, we will see our current time in seconds. Here, in this time function, we are passing null to skip storing the result in an external variable and only return the current time. If I declare one more variable myTime with the data type time_t, which is also declared in time.h header file. And now, if I pass the address of this variable to our time function, then our current time will also be stored in this myTime variable. That's why we see the same value in both of these variables. But the thing is, this time is in seconds. How can we format it into the human readable form? For that, we can use cTime. This function is also found in time.h header file. All we have to do is to pass the value that we got from the time function to this cTime, and this function will convert it into a human readable form. Then there is also a function to find how much your program used processor time using this clock function. This clock function returns the current processor time. So at the start of the program, we will call this clock function and store the current processor time in a variable. And at the end, we will call this function again and store the processor time in another variable. After that, we can use a formula like this to find out how much time has passed. First, we are subtracting end time and start time, and then we are dividing it by clocks per second. This clocks per second is a macro defined in time.h. It represents the number of clock ticks per second. And with this formula and our clock function, we can find how much time our program used. These are some pretty useful functions in time.h header file, but there's more. We can also add delay to our C program using this header file. First, we need to define a struct variable. And to add 2 seconds delay, we need to set tv_sec property of that struct to 2, which means seconds equals 2. And then the value of nanosecond to 0, because we want exactly 2 seconds of delay. After this, we need to call nanoslip function and pass the address of our struct variable and null keyword. Congrats! You have successfully added 2 seconds of delay in your program. After time.h, we have none other than the stdio.h file. As we know, this file contains printf function to print stuff to the terminal, and the scanf function for scanning the input. Without this header file, your program would be just silent. But apart from just printing and scanning from the terminal, you can also write data to a file using the same header file. This fprintf function writes data to a file. Just pass the file pointer and the message to write. If I run this program, we won't see any output because we are printing to a file. That means we are writing to a file. So if I will open the message.txt file, we will see what we have written. Subscribe. Do what it says, because most of you guys never click that subscribe button. And to read from a file, we can use fscanf. Pass the file pointer, then the format specifier for the type of data we will be reading, and then the variable in which we will save our data. Let's print that variable, and now we see the content of our file. These functions that you see, fopen and fclose, also come from the stdio.h file. Some other functions this header file includes are the remove function, which deletes the file from the system. All you have to do is to pass the file name to this function, and the rename function, which renames the given file. First pass the old name and then pass the new name, and your file will be successfully renamed. Next one is math.h. As the name suggests, this contains some very interesting mathematical functions like square root. For calculating square root, just pass the variable or a number and it will calculate the square root. As you can see here, the square root of 100 is 10. Did you know about it? Same like that, we can use CBRT function to calculate cube root, log function to calculate log with base e, and log 10 function to calculate log with base 10. The data type of my variable is int, but here I am writing %.2f because the values written by this function have data type of float, and I am using .2 because I want only 2 numbers after the decimal point. There's also a function to calculate power. Like to calculate 2 raised to 3, we call the power function and first we pass 2 and then the 3. And we see the value of 2 raised to 3, that is 8, printed in our terminal. Apart from these functions, this math.h has some pretty useful constants. Like mpy to get the value of pi and me to get the value of e. So make sure to include this math.h header file whenever you are doing some calculations in your C program. Next on the list is string.h. Most of you must be familiar with this header file. It contains various functions to manipulate strings. Like this strlen function returns the length of a string. Just pass the string to this function and it will return the length of that string. After this, we have strcopy. This function copies the value of one string variable to another. The first argument is the destination variable and the second argument is the source variable. Here, the value of str1 will be copied to str3. Since the value of str1 is hello, if we print the value of str3, it will be also hello. Then we have strcat, which concatenates the two string. In simple words, it adds the two string. So as you can see here, we see the addition of these two strings. After this, we have strcmp, which compares the strings. Just pass two strings. And if the value of these two strings are equal, this function will return 0. And if the function returns value less than 0, that means that the str1 is smaller than str2. And if the function returns the value greater than 0, it means str1 is greater than str2. Here we are simply comparing if these two strings are same, and they are not. The last one is stdlib.h header file. But before we dive into this header file, let's talk about the stdarg.h header file. This one is also pretty handy. Using stdarg.h header file, you can pass a variable number of arguments to a function. Isn't that amazing? I already explained how it works in my 6C language tricks video. So if you want to see how this magic happens, check that out. This stdlib.h header file provides a collection of functions for memory management, random number generation, and some other things. The infamous malloc and calloc functions are also in this library. Let's say we have an array of size 5 and this size is fixed. Once an array is declared, we can't change its size. So if we wanted to increase it to 10, we wouldn't be able to. We will need to declare a new array. But with malloc or calloc, we can easily create an array with dynamic size, meaning we can change the size of our array throughout the program. In this program, we first ask the user to enter the size of the array. Now, we could do this with a fixed array too. But while declaring the dynamic array, we use the malloc function like this. We declare a pointer to a memory location that will hold our array. Since we want to store integer values in our array, we write int star followed by the malloc function, passing the size we need. Here we do simple calculation, the size provided by the user multiplied by the size of an integer. If the given size is 5, multiplying that by the size of an integer, which is 4 bytes, gives us 20 bytes, so 20 bytes will be allocated for our array. Another way to do this is with calloc. The syntax is almost the same, but it takes two parameters. First, the array size and then the size of each element. With malloc, we just pass the total block size. The main difference is that malloc doesn't initialize the memory it allocates, so it may contain garbage values. Calloc, on the other hand, automatically initializes the memory to zero. In this case, I will use malloc to create an array, store some values, and then print it. Let's see if it works or not. Enter the size, let's go with 10, and it works. Now the big question is, how do we change the size of our array during the program? For that, we use the realloc function. Realloc stands for reallocate. Just pass your array and the new size. Like I said earlier, if we declare a fixed array of 5, we can't change its size to 10 during the program. But with a dynamic array, we can easily change its size to 10 like this if we want. Finally, when we no longer need the array, we use the free function to release the memory. Just pass the array to free and the memory will be deallocated. Besides managing memory, we can also generate random numbers using this header file. We will also need time.h header file for this. Let's generate 5 random numbers using the rand function. We don't need to pass anything, just call rand and we see our random numbers. But there's a problem. Every time we run the program, the random numbers are the same, they don't change. This happens because these functions generate pseudo-random numbers based on a seed value. And since we aren't setting the seed, the same default seed is used each time. To fix that, we can call the srand function, which is used to set the seed. we can use the current time as the seed value. Now when we run it, our numbers will be truly random. So that's the end of this video, and here's a little surprise. You guys showed so much love on the last part, and some of you even asked for a long video on C programming. So if we hit 40k subs by the end of this month, I will make a full, really long video covering almost everything about C, including some cool projects. I know 40k is a lot, but I need that motivation to work on such a long video. So
please sub sarakarai sarak whatever.